Test. 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 Test, test, test.
If I could please move forward and find a seat where possible, just so other people can get in through the doorway. Thank you.
It's not the equipment or anything. It's just the building itself.
Maybe it needs to come. He said he doesn't. He didn't want the mic.
Don't worry, he's got a.
Do you have the agenda?
Yep.
Okay. Ready to sing the flag song anytime you're ready to sing.
Okay.
Okay. Can everybody hear me? All right then. We're gonna have our singers sing out these beautiful Eagle staffs, these flags representing our nations. So if you can, rise up, and to our singers, Nagamun.
Thank you.
thank you so much to our Eagle Staff carriers, our leaders, who led us down the march. We're going to have a victory song now. So everybody, please keep standing.
My name is Clayton Thomas Mueller. I'm a Cree man from Pukitawagan First Nation, Treaty 6 Territory. I'm also a resident of Pig City, hey? All right. I'm gonna be your MC tonight. We're going to jump right into it. If y'all can grab your seats. We're going to begin with an incredible panel of leaders from different territories across Turtle Island. So if I can get all of our panelists to come up and join me. So I'm going to invite the Grand Chief of the Assembly of Manitoba Chiefs, Grand Chief Derek Nepinak, to come on up and give some opening remarks. Oh, prayer. Elder Joe Masconce is going to give the opening prayer to start us off from the Saisi Dene Nation, which is awesome. So we got Cree, Dene, Métis here in Anishinaabe territory. All kinds of folks jigging here. Okay.
Good evening, gentlemen. Good evening, people. It is my honor and privilege to say the opening prayer at this gathering. I didn't know anything about this gathering until my friends told me about it. So I got myself together and I said I'm going to do it. But it's for the people, for everybody. Nobody's left out. And I know that the elders, most of the elders that are here, and I'm with the Aboriginal Veterans Association, the president, and you could call me the boss, I guess, but anyways, Creator, I ask you this today to bless all these people and guide them and help us. And help us to regain our territory and our things that belong to us, that you gave us, that was taken away from us by a foreign country. And I think, and I'm glad to see this happening. I've been waiting for this for many years. I'm 75 years old. I'm on my way out. But there's young people who have to learn about our rights, our rights and our who they are. Because majority of the young people were taken away, the 60 school and other places, and residential school. And I was fortunate enough not to be in that bond, because my parents, I still had my parents. And with that, I say, bless you all. And I thank you, Heavenly Father, for this day, for the beautiful sun that you gave us. And so for everything that around us, I'm happy to say that I love all of you, every one of you. I don't incriminate anybody. I just, people I love. And one thing I learned a long time ago, that you have to love the people, but you don't have to like them. See, that's the trouble. That's the best part of it. You don't have to like them. I ask you now, I thank you again. I say it, I know only a few words in Dene. Masi cho. Thank you.
Thank you so much to our Dene Elder for that beautiful opening prayer and words. We're going to jump right into our program, ladies and gentlemen. We've got a dynamic panel of speakers here. Again, I'll be your MC for tonight. We've got an incredible panel of speakers here. I'll introduce them once I'm introducing them to speak. But I wanted to have our first speaker come up. Of course, that's Grand Chief Derek Nepinak of the Assembly of Manitoba Chiefs. Let's give a big round of applause to AMC and all the volunteers that came together to make today so beautiful. Grand Chief Nepinak.
Miigwech. Bonjour, Anishinaabe. Thank you for coming out this evening. Thank you for walking and marching and helping raise the spirits of thousands of people in Winnipeg, thousands of people in Manitoba and across the nation. Thank you so much for your war call out to those who are standing on the front lines in Standing Rock, all those people around the world who are raising their awareness and their consciousness about the changes that we need to make, the changes that we need to make now. We are living in a critical time. My brothers, my sisters, my friends, my relatives, this is a very critical time, very critical juncture in history where we need to start making that transition. I know it's going to be difficult and it's very, very challenging for all of us. Microphone switch. Do I sound clear? This journey of the totem pole started many months ago when I met with Ruben out on the West Coast, and I went out there to support the Tsleil-Waututh Nation and their challenge to Kinder Morgan and the pipeline expansion that's happening in that territory. To go beyond that, there's another important person here that's not here today that had family matters to deal with in the Mohawk territory. That's a very good friend of mine. His name's Serge Simon. He's a Grand Chief of the Mohawks. We've shared time together and we've talked about building a treaty alliance to talk about resistance towards the expansion of the tar sands. And if you've ever been out to the tar sands, you know what's happening out there. I had the fortunate opportunity in 2014 to carry the Chief's Unity Bundle and make the 16-kilometer walk in the healing walk around the tar sands. And I can tell you that nothing is living, nothing is surviving in that space. Nothing can survive in that space. When the birds fly into the tailing ponds, they die on that water. So every few seconds there's a cannon that sounds to try and keep the birds away. That's the type of environment that's being created in that space. Contrary to media, contrary to what corporate industry is trying to tell you, nothing can live in that space. So if you're supporting pipelines that come through our treaty territories out here, you're supporting tar sands expansion. And we as the original people have to understand, because we look at the world in a holistic way. We don't look at one project at a time. We look at the impacts of all these projects as they come together and contribute to a future that's unsustainable. We have to get in the way now. We have to get in the way now because our children and our future grandchildren are depending on us to be the leaders that we need to be. You know, we live in a world of social media and many, many difficult things are happening in different parts of the world. We saw the other day what happened down in Standing Rock. And I was down there last year. I raised my pipe, that wounded knee. And I raised my pipe to all the fallen people and all the fallen families of that territory that went down there. You know, and I sensed the great power of the people. And you know, I see the images on social media just like all of you have seen. You've seen the dogs attacking unarmed children and women and men. You've seen pepper spray. And I raised this question yesterday when I saw these images on social media. I said there's guns, attack dogs, and pepper spray versus love, humility, empathy, caring, and compassion. And I asked, which side of history do we want to be remembered for? Which side of history do we want to be part of? You know, they can bring great force to people. Governments have a monopoly on the use of force. That's been the case for a very, very long time. But nothing can compare to the power of love that we have for our lands and for our people and for the future of all children. When I started on my trail in leadership, an elder in Treaty 6 told me that I had to walk with a kind heart. I had to walk in kindness. And I ask all of you that as these discussions become more intense around your home fire, whether that be in your home community or whether you're part of the urban community, as they become more intense, I ask you to be kind to one another. Be kind to one another, because we're all in this together. And you know, we can't create division amongst one another, pro-pipeline this or anti-pipeline that. We have to find a way to see beyond that, to see the greater purpose of our existence as human beings and come together as one family. I've identified a number of people who I've worked with over the years that have made and brought very significant impacts to the way I think about the future that we could have. I brought together people who I know are making contributions, not just standing up to say no, but also coming forward with solutions and alternatives. And that is what I believe this panel represents right here. This panel represents a beacon of hope for the future. And we need to listen to them. We need to hear what they have to say. Because these people who are here, they're not just talking about stopping something. They're actually talking about advancing something good. And that's really why they're here today. And I'm so happy that you're here to listen to this message, because it needs to continue to grow. Popular media will often tell you that, you know, the indigenous people are just standing in the way with no solutions. But the truth is, we've always, always had the solutions ready. We've always had the solutions ready because we have lived successfully in these territories for thousands and thousands of years as the original people. We have the solutions. We've always had the solutions. And as I said, this totem pole that's out here today, it transcends politics. Okay, because politics will often take us into a space where we argue about money. And we argue about contracts and different opportunities that this pipeline and this or that pipeline represent. But you know what? It transcends that, because there's more fundamental questions that are in play. And that's going to be discussed. That's going to be discussed here. It's going to be discussed at your home fires. And I want you to be invigorated and empowered by what you've witnessed here today, as thousands of our people came out and we talked about building the resistance. There is nothing, nothing on Turtle Island that is stronger than the indigenous people saying no. There is nothing stronger than that. We have the key, we have the power to withhold our consent to what is happening in our ancestral lands. Don't you ever forget that. You hold the key, because you have the power to withhold your consent to anything happening in your home territories. Never, ever forget that. So with that, Miigwech, thank you for being here today.
Thank you. Can y'all hear me? Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much, Grand Chief Nipinak. We're going to jump right into our speakers. Our first speaker, I'm really, really, really honored to introduce, and that's Master Carver Jewel James, the leader of the House of Tears Carver Society of the Lummi Nation. And we're really, really honored to have him and the gift that his nation and his society that he belongs to, that they brought. Jewel James is the Master Carver who selected, designed, and carved the 22-foot totem pole that we have with us here today. James is the head of the House of Tears Carvers and a longtime leader of the Lummi Indian Nation. James is also a forceful advocate for worldwide environmental restoration and preservation. Please join me in welcoming Master Carver Jewel James here to the Thunderbird House in Treaty 1.
With me, my brother Douglas Sitikatum, my Indian name Sasiah, means younger than Seattle. Chief Seattle was a lineal uncle. He had three sisters that were married out in the Northwest. We married between tribes to form alliances. We're really proud to be here. been a long journey, 8,000 kilometers, 5,000 miles. We're really happy to be working with our First Nations relatives. They're from Washington State, Lummi Indian Reservation. We're really proud to be Coast Salish. We're proud of the Lummi Nation for letting us come on this journey. I, myself, and Dr. Russo, hiding in the audience back here, we worked for the Lummi sovereignty, treaty rights, over 30 years, almost 37 years. That's what we mainly do, protect the treaty rights and the sovereignty of the Lummi Nation. We form alliances with other tribes. Also, because we believe it takes a lot of people to stand united. We need that one thought, one prayer, one voice. Unity. So when we were asked whether or not we think of the people of Manitoba and their chief, we were happy. We were happy. We put one golden ball up with the Lake on the west, marking our northern brothers and sisters, the Beaver Lake Bridge, Northern Alberta, we put a second wall up. To mark our southern access, we pull on that Northern Cheyenne. All of us are fighting coal trains, oil trains, pipelines that endanger the air and the water of our people. But not just us, everybody that is dependent upon the water that has their future threatened. We find that unacceptable, so we form these alliances, asking for help and asking everybody else to help those that we form alliances with. We believe it's extremely important to continue the journey. We already won our battle at Lummi. We defeated the corporations that were going to put coal, 52 million tons of coal on top of our ancestors' graves. United Church Christ issues apologies. Since 1987, we've been asking and demanding the Church to issue apologies for what they've done to our people, destroying our sense of place, the sacredness of our territory, destroying our language and our spirituality. And so, they've apologized, and we're telling them that's not enough. We want action. You got to walk with us, talk with us, hear what we have to say. Our compromising, our painted people in our traditional way. My wife, who's not here, is a painted person. She's attended six county meetings praying for the totem pole. We have an eagle on top of it. We have spread wings, and there's a lot of loot. On the way, on the chest of the moon sign. If you look at the full moon when it rises on the eastern sky between 9 and 11, you'll see a lady, person, legs crossed, hands on her lap, head down, and two feathers on her forehead. Think of the full circle around that person as he prays. According to the Algonquin, it's a medicine woman. The medicine woman that was a hero. All she had to do was pray. She'll take the answers from the Great Spirit on how to heal anything. On the front of the tail cluster is a blue face. That's Father Sky, symbolically. We have a wolf and a bear and a spear in between. They're not touching the spear because they're buffalo. And inside the southern white buffalo is a female. The Cheyenne River said that one time, according to her teaching, the old devil buffalo, and there was a woman inside it. It's one of their sacred myths. That was really a great thing for us to hear that, because at the time, we were talking about alone to figure out what's supposed to go on these poles. Pray, hoping that I was doing the right thing. When we came to Yakima, a Peony old man came out and prayed over the pole. On the bottom right of the pole was a young Native warrior following the Peony trail with a teepee and the regalia carved onto it. On the left, there was a pipe carrier getting ready to pray. We're really proud that we're able to go to Greengrass. Uncle Phil, Brother Phil brought us there. So all we're looking for is a prayer over the golden pole. We find these as indications that we're on the right spiritual trail, that we're going in the right direction. It's all about unity of our people. It's all about not being afraid to stand up, to accept the tradition, the song, dance, ceremony, the legend, myth, and folklore, the traditional knowledge of our elders that's been handed down. They couldn't wipe it out. We still have it. We still believe it. And it will fire us. Because they're dying of cancer up there from the tar sack. Reuben's mother was crying. They went up there and they saved the cancer from the water. The animals have cancer, the birds have cancer, and the people, the children have cancer. I see these mothers crying. Crying for them. That's why we want north. That's why we brought a fall up there. Bring prayers here. We went down to Standing Rock. And they're standing strong. They have over 100 nations brought their flags there, standing up a Standing Rock, telling them they're right and we support you. This is the type of belief that we have in ourselves. As my brother has said, and the elders of Manitoba have said, the totem pole isn't sacred. What makes it a sacred thing is everyone of you coming to in unity, that creates the sacredness of our nation. We're proud to give the totem pole to the non-global chiefs, to their people. Thank you for the honor of carving it. The log was donated by the Lummi Nation. It was carved on our reservation by the House of Tears Carvers. The youngest one to work on it was 2 and a half. My little granddaughter painted on the bottom. I painted all the way around, but I left all the painting on the bottom, 2 and a half. She was just full of joy after painting. This is why we do it. This is why we do it. Sometimes we sing as we travel across the country, mid-crying. There was a time in the city you should be crying if you have. We told them, you should be crying because you remember your mom is still in your heart. And you can't forget that because that binds you to the earth. That keeps you bound to the earth. That Mother Earth with all of us. So with that, I want to thank you for the honor. Thank you for receiving this. Thank you, our brothers, for helping us get here. Ask my brother to say the final word.
First of all, I'd like to give the credit and glory back to our Creator for allowing us this breath of time to come together with one heart and one mind. It's this one heart and one mind unity that's going across all of our Indian country. It's binding that strength and that unity together. And when we all come together and pray together, it creates such a tremendous power that nothing can stop it. If we teach our children to pray in the right way. They can change your life. They can change your family's way. They can change and make a difference in your community. Where these little ones are very, very powerful because they're innocent and they're pure. Their prayers are very powerful. So we just want to praise and thank God and say, thank us for allowing us to come here upon this land. To mix our tracks with the ancestors here, our ancestors, leaders of this land, and Haishka, thanking you for allowing us this breath of time to come here and share this unity together. Pay close attention to what's happening throughout all Indian country. There's a great movement. The spirit's on the move like it's never moved before, and it's only getting stronger. This is not just an Indian affair. It's every walk of life that flows down these rivers, every walk of life, everything that exists upon this earth is dependent on the water. The four legs, everything. So, this is where it begins. It begins with the First Nations. Our hands are out to you for allowing us to share throughout the time with you. Hands are out to you.
We're so honored. We're just so honored. I'm going to introduce our next speaker on our panel. We're working out the sound stuff as we go. This mic's working okay though, right? No.
Better when I just talk?
Yeah.
Yeah. Alright.
Oh, man.
Well, I'm going to introduce our next speaker. I'm going to give him a mic though if he wants it. But this protocol is going to send Angel Shane to the Great Lodges in our territory, the Lodge. And the next speaker is Dr. Angel Shane, for his founder, creator, King Bert Man, Sean. He's from Saggy First Nations Treaty 1 territory. He's traveled internationally carrying a message of hope and peace. Elder Shane shares the ancient knowledge of the original peoples of Turtle Island. And he believes Kanab is the foundation for supporting the new life that Mother Earth is now entering. And that the elders have confirmed has arrived. Dave and the other elders have been providing guidance and direction for the wonderful journey events here in Treaty 1 territory. Tomorrow, Elder Shane will conduct the ceremony at Totem Pole Graves on sacred lands near Turtle Lodge of Saigi, where he takes That's care of that. So please join me
Chief
in welcoming
Bear,
in the way,
right?
Leading Earth Man, Elder Dave Shane.
Bojo,
is it on?
Can you hear me?
No.
I might, the best thing might be just to stand right here and speak up into there. There's this thing that happens. I don't know. It's like a natural microphone, eh? Y'all can hear me back here?
Oh, yeah, we can.
Test.
How's this?
Maybe sound.
That's true.
I don't have it off. I think there's things in place. I think I should.
Can you go stand there and test the form? Test the form.
Testing.
Hold on.
One side. For those of you that follow astrology, Mercury is in retrograde.
Test.
When that happens.
Test. Test.
Is it good?
Test. Test.
Let's see. The mic.
Hello. Testing. 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 Test. Mats?
Test.
No?
Test. Testing. Test.
Can you hear me? Hello? Hello?
Anyway, do you want as possible to try and...
He's a soft guy. He's not a big mouth like you'll meet.
I know. That's why I was like, oh, dang, I got to get Dave a mic.
Test. Test.
Long run. I thought Doc was going to follow.
Hey, where's our friend with the megaphone from the North End? North End megaphone. You around here?
My buddy with the megaphone, are you here? From the North End crew? North End Mike, no?
Testing one.
If somebody can get him and bring his megaphone, that'll be awesome.
Testing.
Testing.
Last time we had an event here, we just couldn't speak right into the mic. We had to hold it away.
Yeah,
from the
we've been trying. Hello.
I fear if we keep focusing on that, we're not gonna.
Testing.
Yeah, is there a way we can keep
testing
while Elder Crescent is speaking, and then we can give him the mic if it starts working?
Somebody's got that thing.
That's good.
I think all the AYO people laugh or anything is testing.
Testing.
I'll turn on the old sound system.
Okay.
He's turning on the sound system in here.
Yeah.
But it's not the best, but whatever, right?
Yeah. Okay, here we go.
No.
Yeah.
This one works better.
Can you hear me? Ujo Anin. Dinemaganituk. Nigani Akin in this Nikas. Can you do the name? Sagging Donjiba. Sibo I abajituan in a gigitatwim stigoji. Ni abajiton gain anin gagijmini goes at any sinabe chigigitat. Mi wetsmin on the na. Mayaga mi get it madise when mi wegizemani do. Ye give me not kinagego, kewin anishinabe, aningewin chai at mi women of madise when. Mi gwetskin dena gizemani do. Ye give me not gain anishinabe, aningewinchi chinandago is it, aningewinchi chimikout is it. Mi gwets dena gizemani do. He gave me not a poche and an away, Anishinabe, Sibijiga take away, Kishimitik, Mianishe, Eje, Majizit Anishinabe, E Penimut, Pocheganan, Midashyama Dam in Minanongum, Animeneke Pichizonga Kawaya Gabacha, Gabachiget, Evamadai go is at Gawin, Anin Gawin Shonokitang if Majizuan. My dear relatives, it is indeed an honor and a privilege to be able to offer a few words. I first of all want to acknowledge the leaders that carried the symbol of leadership, which was the eagle staffs. To carry an eagle staff comes a great responsibility. As leaders, you are to lead your people with a vision. A vision that could guide the people towards a good life. And a leader's responsibility is to rely on the teachings of their ancestors that have lived upon this land for thousands and thousands of years. You cannot lead your people if you cannot love your people. You cannot lead your people if you cannot love the land. That is why I must acknowledge the leaders that carry these Eagle Staffs. Also, I acknowledge the gift of the drum and the singers that have shared their gift to offer the songs of our people. As I heard the drum, and I hope that you felt the way that I felt, and I felt overwhelmed to be able to hear the ancient gift that the Creator had given us as a people so that we could be heard, so that the drum can carry the voice of the people. And we have a strong voice when we are using the gifts that the Creator had given us as a people. We are a beautiful people. We are a spiritual people. And we are a people that love the land. And our responsibility is that we must remind those that have arrived on our homeland the rules of conduct in living in our homeland. And we must be relentless in terms of never losing patience. And we must be very, very careful that we must not find ourselves in an environment of any type of violence, because that is not our way. We will be heard around the world for who we are as a people. We are the true stewards of the land. This is a duty and responsibility our great Creator had given us, to remind those that have come on our homeland how we should be treating the land, because the land is what we depend on for our survival as human beings. People that continue to say that they're going to save the earth do not understand what they are saying. We are here to be a voice of the land, because the land will be the deciding factor to determine the change that's going to happen within the attitude of the human beings. We cannot continue to show disrespect to the earth. And this is what we must be and continue to be as a people, a voice of the earth itself, a voice of the mother herself, that we're here to take care of her, to look after her. And our children must be centered for everything that we do in our life. We must do it for our children. And we must put our grandmothers back into the rightful place of honor, because they carry the deepness of the understanding of the sacredness of life. And we must show respect for our own mothers. So many children are being displaced and being removed from their own families. We have to make that journey to reclaim our duty and responsibility to be good parents, to be good families and strong families. And it can only happen when we reclaim our right of identity in who we are as a people, that we must move beyond this imposition that we are living in the environment today. I want to thank the Lummi Nation and those that helped the Lummi Nation bring this sacred pool to us. Phil Lane has been a friend for a number of years. Reuben George, he reminded me the last time we had seen each other was in Rio in Brazil, carrying out the same work that we do together, to share with the world what a beautiful people that we are and why we love the land so much. What we are witnessing here today is a fulfillment of prophecy that was predicted and foretold by our visionaries and prophets. We are rising again, and we are claiming our right of our true leadership in our homeland, because we are the true leaders of our homeland. But it comes with duties and responsibilities. And it is the knowledge keepers that remind us of those duties. Finally, I want to make an invitation to all of you to come and witness as the sacred pool is lifted in our lodge tomorrow morning. And I hope that you're all able to come and join us in that way. Thank you, thank you. Kichimi Gwesh to all of you.
Thank you so much to Elder Dave Kershane from the Turtle Lodge. Our next speaker has traveled up from across that medicine line. You know, that's what our native people, they call the U.S.-Canada border imposed on our lands. They call it the medicine line because when our Lakota relatives, those ancestors came over during the Great Indian Wars, they would cross that line and the cavalry would stop and they wouldn't even shoot them. So they said it must be medicine. They call it the medicine line. But we know that border don't... That border's crossed us. We didn't cross the border, as they say. And so the next speaker is a dear friend and mentor of mine, somebody that I really look up to, and I've learned a tremendous amount of things from. Her name is Winona LaDuke. She is a graduate of Harvard and Anatok Universities, and she is an internationally acclaimed and renowned activist working on issues of sustainable development, renewable energy, and food systems. She lives and works in the beautiful White Earth Reservation, Anishinaabe Nation, in northern Minnesota. And she is the two-time vice presidential candidate with Ralph Nader for the Green Party. As program director of Honor the Earth, she works nationally and internationally on issues of climate change, renewable energy, and environmental justice with Indigenous communities. Ladies and gentlemen, young people, please help me in welcoming Winona LaDuke to speak here in the Thunderbird House Treaty 1.
Thank you. Anin Nindo Magadaduk. Binisiquin Jinakas, Makwando Deam, Gawababani Kag, Ishkanaganing, Indunjba, Miigwech. It's an honor to be here with you today. I did drive up across that medicine line to be with you. It was really important. I went home. I was at Standing Rock earlier this week. I went home to pick vegetables in my garden and can. And then I come up after I got my tomatoes put away. So we're good because we have to take care of how we're going to eat in the future. So we got to do. So I want to be with you because these are my brothers and my sisters and all of you. I'm really encouraged and proud to be here and really encouraged by your courage and your commitment and your hard work for all of us and the beauty that you bring here, Oma King, to this land. And I'll tell you a little story about us and my community. We have a good life too. I don't know how you're doing, but my corn is doing good. Our rice is doing pretty good down there. I don't know how your rice is up here. You know, the gardens are good, my tobacco plants are good, so I'm grateful. I'm grateful to the Creator, you know. And what I have to say is, Mino Bamadaziwin, the Creator gave us a good life. The Creator gave us a very good life, and it is our responsibility and our privilege to be able to carry that on. And that's what we intend to do. We have seen some who have come to try to take that from us. They have different names. They are different corporations and they are different governments. And they always come to us because they want to take that away because they have a different view of the world. But we still stand. We still stand. In my community, we fought off a lot of these guys. We're pretty tough down there at White Earth. The Enbridge even sent down two Indian whisperers so far. They are not doing any good down there. I have to say, you know, we defeat one nuclear waste dump proposal a few years back. You know, we defeat proposals to genetically engineer wild rice. They did not do that. And now, I don't know if you was watching what happened with the proposed Sandpiper. Big pipeline proposed by Enbridge. They come in, they already got some lines north of our reservation, but they came in with a new line proposal out of what's called the Bakken oil fields. Out of western North Dakota, it was called the Sandpiper. You want to put in a whole new line. So, you know, I spent 4 years fighting that company. I went to almost all those hearings. We faced them many times. I said, you cannot do that to us. We are not weak people, and we are not going to bow to you. We went to every hearing, and then my tribe did some things that other tribes have done, other nations have done. Our tribe said the state of Minnesota and the federal government are not capable of handling this. So we are going to hold our own hearings. That's what we're going to do. We're going to talk about what you want to do, Enbridge. And we're going to listen, and we're going to hold our own hearings, and we are going to exercise our own jurisdiction over your proposals. So that is what our tribe did, and that's what the Mille Lacs Band of Ojibwe did. And when we did that, the Enbridge Company started to have more and more problems. That is what we did in the legislative and the regulatory scheme, and then we prayed. We had ceremony, and we rode our horses for 4 years. 4 years we rode our horses against the proposed current of the oil. And what happened here about a few weeks ago is that they announced that they are not going to put that pipeline in. That is what happened. And when they came down with all their money and all their Indian whispers, it did not do them any good. But what I know is that they pulled up in our territory, and what did they do? They went west and bought that Dakota Access Pipeline. And what I will tell you is that a Canadian corporation has blood on its hands from putting dogs on Indian people. It's the Enbridge Corporation that is party to that. And we need to hold them accountable up in this country. We need to hold them accountable because you do not put dogs on Indian people. This is not 1492. This is not 1904. This is 2016, and we are people that are not going to stand for that anymore. I was at meetings with Enbridge a few weeks ago, and I said, you are wasting my time because your vision is blurry and you have no good plan for the future. The fact is that what they are trying to do is bring new infrastructure for energy independence. They're spending billions of dollars on infrastructure that brings pipelines for rich people and for oil companies and does not address the fact that our tribal communities don't have adequate infrastructure. The fact is that what we want is infrastructure that serves people. We want water you can drink. That's what we want. We want housing that is suitable for our people. We want energy that makes sense for our people, that comes from the sun and comes from the wind, and comes from what our elders have always said, which is this is the time that these people are all talking about, the time that is now, the time is when we change, we make that change away from that colonial predator economy, back to what we need it to be. So I stand here in front of you, you know, and what I see is where we are going, and you all know where it is we are going, but we must take that time. It is not an alternative. It is not alternative energy. It is the enlightened path. That is what we need to say, is that there's nothing that is marginal about what we are talking about. This is survival. You know, I drove up here in one car. I drove up here in a pickup truck, just like about a third of you, right, you know? But what I know is that, you know, I spent my whole life in the petroleum economy. I did not choose to live in this era. But what I know is that a combustion engine is 16% efficient, and an electric engine is 65% efficient. 16% efficient. Now, what kind of a dumb society would continue to live that in a way that is only 16% efficient? What we want is the future. What we want is what is here now, and we want it in our communities. We don't want to be the last people to get solar energy. We don't want to be the last people to have everything cool. We want it now, and we want it in our communities. So when I was at Standing Rock last week, I met with the tribal chairman. And I say, everybody is looking at your community right now. And everybody sees what is going on, and everybody knows that we have the moral high ground. We have the moral high ground because we are the people who are standing with our ancestors, standing for our future generations, and standing to protect our sacred water. Everybody in the world is looking at Indian people right now. That is what is going on, and we need to be clear. We need to be clear on our message. It is not just about saying no to them, because we are going to say no to them. We are saying no all the way to them. But what we are also saying is that we are very clear what we want. And that's what I told the tribal chairman at Standing Rock. I said, when this is over, you should not only, there should be no pipeline for sure, but you know what? There should be $3.9 billion in renewable energy out there in our territories. That's what we need. Is it, you know, we need to be done with this stuff. And so, you know, from my perspective, that's what we need to be very clear about. We want justice, and that is what justice looks like. Justice looks like that our children have a shot, and that we have renewable energy, that we have local food, and we are not poisoning ourselves. It is not just about saying no. It is holding that ground and saying this is what the future looks like. And in our prophecies, the time of the seventh fire and the time of the eighth fire is when we make that future. And we are the ones who are going to do that. Be clear. Do not be, you know, I heard this one guy say one time, it's always funny when he said, I heard this one guy say one time, you're either at the table or you are on the menu. I'm not going to be on the menu. I want to be at the table and I want to be deciding what is served. It's our time. Take your power, people. Take it now because everybody is counting on it and everybody in the world is looking at us right now. This is our time to push them back. So what I decide here about a month ago is that I'm not going to spend my time fighting one pipeline after another pipeline and go chase this pipeline. I said, I'm going after Enbridge. Those guys are not fiscally responsible. They are not responsible. They are not capable of taking care of what they already got, which is 50-year-old pipelines with holes in them in our community. They need to clean up their old mess, and they need to do it right now, and that is very expensive. They need to tell the Canadian people and the First Nations who have pipe laying on their land where those faulty pipes are that they bought in Thailand. All those pipes they bought at some kind of discount. We want to know where they are. We want to know where they are now. We want to know if they're under our communities because it's our liability, or we want to know if they're sitting in a stockpile, they're going to put them in. We want to know. We want a full disclosure. That's what we want. And so what I'm saying is let us work together, all of us. Let us fight back our enemy to wherever they came from and tell them that they need to not only clean up their old mess, but their time is over. It is over. And let us make that future, because that future is right here. It is right here with the intelligence we have and all that is around us and our prayers and our ceremonies. That future is here, but we must take the actions to make that possible. We must care for our families, care for our children, and we must move towards that energy that is life-affirming. That is what we must do. Thank you so much. So honored to be here. Very much.
Thank you so much. Such powerful words from Winona LaDuke. I'm going to continue moving us forward with this amazing panel of leaders. This next leader that is going to speak to us is part of a young, dynamic crew of youth leaders here in the city of Winnipeg. And, you know, just a few words before I read her bio, you know, these young people here in Winnipeg that are doing all this amazing work at the University of Winnipeg, University of Manitoba, I've been blown away by them. And Sadie Phoenix Lavoie is a young leader from Saguenay First Nations Treaty 1 territory. She studies Indigenous Studies and Political Science at the University of Winnipeg and holds a Vice President position on the University of Winnipeg Student Association. Sadie is heavily involved in grassroots initiatives like Idle No More, Divest U Winnipeg, and the Indigenous Course Requirement at the University of Winnipeg. Yeah. She recently traveled to the Standing Rock Reservation and spent time amongst the Sacred Stone Camp, which is currently protesting the Dakota Access Pipeline. Please join me in welcoming Sadie Phoenix Lavoie to the mic.
Hello, hello. Anin, Buju. Bonakua Mingazia Kwe, Indijikas, Sagin and Duji, McNagdotem. My name is Sadie Phoenix Lavoie. My spirit name is Looking Eagle Woman. I'm from Sagin First Nations and member of the Turtle Clan. I was born and raised in Sagin, and so I feel very honored to be here to speak. One thing I wanted to say before I start. I went to a sweat the other day at David Blacksmith, and man, it was a much needed sweat. I just remember the feeling I felt when I got out and I went and laid on the ground. And the one thing I felt was my heartbeat, and it was beating with the earth. And you know, I looked up into the sky, and there was clouds rolling in, and there was a big thunderstorm that evening, and I felt so blessed, you know, knowing that I had access to, you know, ceremony and being able to feel grounded in that moment. You know, I also feel very honored and blessed to be here to speak as a youth. What did you feel the last time you saw your mother cry? Did you want to wipe her tears and tell her everything would be okay? The look in her eyes, trying her hardest to believe the words that you share. How throat aching it was to hear her weep to only reply, "I want to believe it will, but I'm badly hurt." That is the feeling I have in my heart. Every day, all I want to do is take away her sadness, wipe away those tears, and hold her until the sobbing stops so that she can begin her healing. How horrible you feel knowing it could have been prevented, and guilty that you may have played a role. How badly you want to right the wrongs. Nothing hurts more than seeing your mother suffer. From the moment we were brought into this world, we were surrounded in water. One of our creation stories talks about how the earth was filled with water till Sky Woman comes down landing on the back of a turtle. Turtle Island is our home. She is our mother, Aki, water, Nipi. Water is the root of all creation. The water we ingest is the exact same water this earth had when Creator put us here. We're here to live among all forms of life. We are fully dependent. As we grow older into children, we play and interact with as many living things as possible, absorbing the energy from the plants and the animals, learning as we go along. We foster those loving, caring relationships with the land and life. As we get older, we observe nature's patterns and learn their gifts. They offer them to us, but not without respect and reciprocity. We give back what we receive. There is no taking in our way of life. There is only passing on. What we give to the lands and water will only pass it back to us and to our future generations. What they give, we honor. For spirituality, for so many years, the colonizers have taken so much from the land, polluted the air, the waters are contaminated, and Mother Earth is passing it back. More and more of our people are getting sick from the unclean water, the contaminated lands, the continuous chemicals in the air, and the greenhouse gases causing climate change. Climate change isn't new. It's been going on for a while. It's just now that the general public and corporations and governments have been playing a blind eye, or ignorance could somehow make their global problems disappear. But we're here to remind them that they can't disconnect themselves. We Indigenous people have seen these changes in the lands, even though that we were under direct attack from the colonial machine since they got here. We recognize that European Western people have been so disconnected from the realities of sustaining life on Earth for centuries that their relationship with the land has now jeopardized all of our survival as human beings. Through colonization and assimilation, capitalism, many countries across the world have been engaging in the destruction of our Mother Earth. It has been centuries, if not always millennia, Indigenous people who have maintained that loving and caring relationship for our Mother Earth. For all that she gives, for all that she provides continuously, even though she's been under direct attack. As humans at the bottom of creation, we are fully dependent on what Mother offers. The great binding law affirms that we cannot escape this relationship as we cannot sever from our mother. She will always be our mother. She has been used and abused that we Indigenous peoples have felt in our hearts. Every attack on her is an attack on the unborn. A direct threat to the future. We were given instructions on how to live on this earth without taking away from which it has not yet come. We spend so much of our energy learning the white man's way to find a way to defeat them that we forget those, to the point that we forgot those original instructions. Our chiefs have got caught up wearing suits in meetings before ensuring that every single member of the community was safe from their encroachment. You know, the elders are being used and disrespected. Children are being taken away. Some chiefs that live in a fallacy that the white man will save our problems. They have caused them. But the solution is in us. It's in our spirits. And we need to feed that spirit, reaffirm our identities of who we are, our languages, our culture, our way of lives, our way of interacting with our foods and our animals. That is the way to sustain life. The Western way can no longer offer us anything we don't already have. The only thing that the white man can do for us is to stop the genocide of our people and the rape of our mother. We can take care of the rest. And to this, I want to say out to the youth, this is your calling. This is where you're welcomed, free of judgment, and will always be loved and valued. The colonial way will only kill your spirit, to the point where you don't even know who you are anymore. Be brave. Be courageous. Your future, your children, they're waiting for you to protect them. Imagine a whole new generation, unstoppable, filled with pride in their identity, with all the knowledge of our ancestors and our elders, and the courage of our warriors. Our warriors don't need to be violent, they need to stand up and voice up. Let me just tell you, if we all get together and unify, grounded in our spirit, that love for the earth and protecting the lands and waters, that pipeline's not coming through here. We will defeat it, because what may seem like the colonial agenda may seem powerful, but the spirit in our hearts is 10 times powerful, if not more. The power of our spirits, and I assure you that is why I'm here, and that is why all you are here. I am aligning myself with Mother Earth because I never want to hear my mother cry ever again. Miigwech.
Sadie Phoenix, one of the most badass organizers here in Pink City. Big love to you, Sadie. Thank you. A big shout out to her crew in the audience. Our next speaker that we have is a very dear friend of mine. I consider him a brother. And we've been doing a lot of good work in his territory. His people have been leading the struggle against the Kinder Morgan pipeline. Reuben George is a member of the Tsleil-Waututh Nation near Vancouver, British Columbia. He is a Sundance Chief and Project Manager for Tsleil-Waututh Sacred Trust Initiative. In this capacity, Ruben continues to play a central role in Tsleil-Waututh's legal challenge against the National Energy Board of Canada's endorsement of the Kinder Morgan's proposed Trans Mountain Tar Sands Pipeline expansion project. Tsleil-Waututh is on record as describing the regulator's decision as unlawful, invalid, or unreasonable. The Tsleil-Waututh Nation also say the pipeline's proposed tanker activities would cause significant adverse environmental effects that were not considered by the National Energy Board. And they also allege that the NEB has failed to consider the Tsleil-Waututh's independent assessment of this ridiculous, absurd project as a matter of its own sovereign law and jurisdiction. Please join me in welcoming Reuben George to speak here at the Thunderbird House in Treaty 1 territory.
I'd like to thank some of the crew that are here that traveled with us. There's Paul. Where's Paul? Where did he go? Is Matt here? Matt, he's doing a live stream on the internet right now. Nancy's right here. And Richard somewhere in the place. But Joel asked me to thank some of the crew. Uncle Doug is somewhere around here over there. Melanie and Uncle Phil. We've been traveling, like Joel said, right across the country. And one thing that's apparent that we see in the United States, it's a $750 to $1 trillion industry annually. And Canada is one of the biggest suppliers. These fossil fuel companies, they buy the government. They do. They buy the media. They even help create the policies. Then they break them, their laws. Then they're not accountable. And what I see, it truly is a David and Goliath battle. I really see that. What I believe and what I see from my people right across Turtle Island, my grandfather was Chief Van George, and he's nominated for Academy Award. And a man came up to me and said, "What do you love? Can you tell me what you love?" And my grandpa said, "My people." And the man said, "I was hoping you would say that. I experienced what he meant when we traveled across Turtle Island, the love for our people. I think of the people in Haida Gwaii that took their chieftainship off two chiefs because they negotiated with Inbridge. The elders stepped in and said, that's going against the laws of who we are. And they took their chieftainship off them. I was there. I witnessed that. Inbridge, our relations, and how they stood up, and how they've been stopping that pipeline. And one of the elders said, how many nails do we have to put in that coffin to end this application for this pipeline? They're winning. I see our Chipotle relations that won one of the biggest historic legal cases in all of the world for Indigenous people. I see our people going to court and winning 170 legal cases around resource extraction. That's 90% legal victories. All those laws that they use to beat this Canadian government are the laws of our culture and our spirituality that supersede any laws that have only been here for the last couple hundred years. And I see, driven by spirit, by love, in our ceremonies, I explain how we do a sweat lodge. Or even in a longhouse. We might start by going collecting the rocks. My daughter was only 4 years old when I took her. I said, okay, you can go pick up a rock. She just stood there and I said, go ahead. And she said, Daddy, I'm going to pick the right one. What's that meant? And she knew in her heart that somebody was going to heal When we built the sled, we put, my mom would come and put tobacco in every single hole for every one of those ribs. That's a ceremony in itself. Picking those up is a ceremony itself. Even when we make the fire, like in our longhouses, that's a ceremony, how we start it, how we get the wood, how we say our prayer. And we understand those things. A tree will reach up to the sun and catch the energy of the sun. Then we'll light it. And they'll heat up a rock, releasing that sun energy on the rocks to heat them up. Those rocks come from the center of Earth. She rejuvenates everything of who we are. She rejuvenates the land and the water. We need that for ourselves, and we ask that spirit of those rocks to give that energy to us in the lodge. Then we sing songs, we put medicine down. We say our prayers, we use our drums and our rattles. If we start to understand any one of those parts of those intricate steps of each one of those ceremonies, and we put them all together, something starts to happen. We have to understand that, because anybody can take water and pour it on rocks. But people need to understand when they do that, that's a ceremony, each one of those. When we start to understand them all, then we start to understand that prayer we all know of all my relations. It's that interconnectedness of each one of those things. And that's how we're all interconnected right here. We understand spirit. We start to understand Mother Earth. All the elements in our ceremony we use. We start to build a reciprocal relationship to those things that we love. Start to love our land, and start to love our water. Jeez, I love my kids. When I go visit my daughter in Seattle, as soon as I get in my car, I'm happy, because that's a reciprocal relationship of a father and daughter where she feeds my spirit, like those ceremonies. Then I learn how to go to Earth. I'll do anything for my daughter, my son. It's a reciprocal relationship with my kids and with Mother Earth. I'll do anything to make sure that reciprocal spiritual relationship that I have with my kids and the earth, that nothing will come in between it. And that means those fossil fuels will not pass through our land. Went across the total pool, people coming in. Some communities had nothing. And they came and they gave, and they're so proud and so happy to do that. Brought us to tears. Because they wanted us to come here with a message of hope for our people, for our lands, and a reciprocal relationship. I met Richard Kinder of Kinder Morgan. I went into their AGM in Texas. I went into their annual general meeting in their house. And I told them, the Canadian Constitution protects our indigenous rights. I told them I'm winning 90% of our court cases. I told them we're going to beat them. I talked to the shareholders like this. And I said, you guys are business natives, people make sound business choices. I said, this is the choice, we're going to stop it. Their stock fell by 60% 4 months after. Their dividends were cut by 75% after. And I start to see with our Indian people all across Turtle Island, when we stand up like this with our allies, that it is a day of life out of the trillion-dollar industry that the Canadians are the biggest supplier, makes us the number one polluter in all the countries of all of the world. What I start to see and start to realize when I look Richard Kinder in the eyes, no spirit there. They put the dubious past in front of me of how we know that we have a reciprocal relationship, the spirit of the land and the water. And we're fighting people that don't even believe in the spirit inside of themselves. They don't even see it, it's blind like that. They believe in that greed. The biggest thing that they're afraid of is that we're going to take their money. That's the biggest thing they're afraid of. And I was happy to look him in his eye and say, you're done. And I saw that fear. The spirit of the indigenous people, of our connection of prayer, is too powerful to put up. It's too powerful that those industries can't stand up to the spirit of our people. We're too big and we're too strong that way, with too much belief and too much conviction. Those industries can't do it. And I've seen that consistently all across our country. It's such a beautiful thing. You know, statistically we know we're 40% of the jail population. Only 3% of Canada's population. We're 40% of homeless and school dropout. Minister Oliver, he said, why don't the First Nations take the money they need it? Maybe we do. Maybe that nation in British Columbia was offered $1.6 billion over a period of time. Maybe that money would have helped them. Maybe what I hear about the $300 million that they offered some of my neighbors, and they said no, maybe that would have helped my people too. Maybe it would have. But that nation that was offered $1.6 billion had 1,000 people vote as 100% consensus to say no. And I've seen that all across our land. I've seen that. And I have nothing but love in my heart for the direction that we're going and things we're doing. And I'm really, really proud to say across Turtle Island, we're winning.
What?
So happy we're winning. We let them know that we won't stand for Mother Earth to die. Her spirit is hurting a bit. Our prayers will uplift her. We will uplift her. She cared for us for so long. It's our turn to turn around and do what she's done for us and fight for her. What do you want to stand in on? Got a message from the chiefs in Washington State. He said they want to come and save time and meet us there. Yakima, 30 people came. Big huge semi full of food brought all the way from Yakima. We had about 11 chiefs. We pulled in there for totem pole. And the people were crying and shaking our hands and hugging us. We're coming together and united. And that pole is so beautiful, Jewel, that he did. In our longhouse, we have poles like this. And they hold up the structure. But our elders said they watch over everything that happens in that ceremony at home and help to bring our prayers up to Creator, like that Sundance tree. And that's the same with a pole. Thousands of people have touched that. This rednecks are coming by and they're like, what are you guys doing? We're going to bring a poll to our relations. Winnipeg Access makes the pipeline and we explain it to them. They go, oh, can we pray?
Yeah, sure.
And they did, and they put prayers on it. Everybody was doing that. But what these polls represent their longhouse. And like the Sundance, you collect prayers. And that poll has collected prayers. Our dear Uncle Dave, all those prayers are going to come and it's going to spread up through the people, and it's happening. It's really happening. I see the spirit awakening. I heard something beautiful. Somebody said, through genocide of what happened to our indigenous people, my own people, 15,000 down to 13, only six generations ago, my people almost extinct, through residential school, segregation, to relocation. They tried to bury us. They really tried to bury us. But what they didn't know is we're seeds and we're growing. Oh, it's my turn.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Reuben George.
This guy's like one of my heroes, eh?
Our next speaker, just a couple more speakers. I want to thank you for listening, actively listening to these wonderful speakers who traveled a long way. Our next speaker is a dear friend, somebody that I really respect. He's been working a very long time to help our people, to help the sacredness of Mother Earth be strong in the hearts of our people. His name is Hereditary Chief Phil Lane Jr. And he is a member of the Akonkwan, Dakota, and Chickasaw Nations. Chief Lane is born to a long lineage of hereditary chiefs and spiritual leaders, and is internationally recognized leader in human, community, and economic development. He's worked across Turtle Island with indigenous peoples from the North, Central, South America, Micronesia, Southeast Asia, Hawaii, India, Africa, all across Mother Earth. And he served 16 years as an associate professor at the Faculty of Education at the University of Lethbridge, Alberta. We're really, really happy to have Chief Phil Lane Jr. here in Treaty 1. Please join me in welcoming him to speak here at the Thunderbird House.
Let's see, let's see. One, two, three, one, two.
Can you hear me all right? Can you hear me all right?
Yep.
Well, I'm getting it. I want to extend a very warm hello to Ken Shane. I really want to thank all the wonderful, beloved relatives here in Manitoba, those in the spiritual world. Jim Bear, Chief Ben Jim Bear, 41 years ago, he welcomed me here to your beautiful, beautiful sacred land. David Machine's father, shortly afterwards, I got a chance to go up to Zagin, where they're going to put that photo where my sister's from. You know, wonderful people, and I thank you very much, Grand Chief, for what you've done. Your great Forest, your Sundance Forest, I thank you for that, that sacrifice. I have a couple of interventions to do that, to be honest. I thank you, brother, for the sacrifice that you and your brother God have made in all the Lummi Nation. It's not sometimes easy to do the work of our own people sometimes. So I thank you. I also want to say, I'm coming around a full circle. I knew your dad about the same time. Great man, good man. I knew your grandfather. I'll tell you what. I tell my dad this all the time, he doesn't believe me. If we are good parents, if we are good elders, if we are good mothers, grandmothers, our young generations have to go way further than us. Right? Because that's how it is. We pray for those who have access to the word. You know, I want to say also, I want to give my really heartfelt thanksgiving to former Prime Minister Stephen Harper, to the U.S. Corps of Engineers, to all these big oil companies, to all these people who are their deep spiritual, profound spiritual sickness and materialistic dream have awakened a sleeping spiritual giant. And that giant is right here in this room. That spiritual giant is rising everywhere. We went down there to, my father was born in Wapapalo, Misanua. My great-grandfather served 40 years there, visiting all seven districts as a spiritual leader there. 40 years, I was in school in the 80s. But we see it come in. When I saw the chairman, vice chairperson of the Navajo Nation stand up, walk in with the Northwest leaders, leaders from the East Coast, all directions, there's no question that our sacred prophecies are being fulfilled right now. And I want to just kind of give a little proof of that. On this very day, 1877, the Shukwe Cove Crazy Horse at the age of 36 was assassinated in Fort Robinson. He was the last one of our great Sioux Nation. The last one holding out holding out. But then he had to look at his women and children, the women and children. He had to look and see the beloved ones. They told him, he'll just come into Fort Robinson. He'll be greeted by the commander of the fort. You'll be welcomed, you'll be honored, people will be taken care of. But the prophecy said, his vision, he could not be killed except by his own people. That's all it was. And by the way, it's that way they colonize us, we find this has killed us the most. It's from life within our own circle, which we have to completely remove now. Sure enough, he came in, and instead of being very big. He took him to the guardhouse and he saw that the master chained him up and locked him up. And so while two of his own guards, they shut the man in his back. Right at this day. Of course, that night, he said that his best friend, Hutchinson, thinking their names were the honor his son so much. Here was heaven and earth. And they said about the most law, the priest said, tell all the people, I am bad word, I deserve it from the Lord, and you can't drop that. Immediately, all the people outside begin to cry, weep, wail. Here is what they said. They said at that time, they said the great Sioux Nation has been destroyed. They will not awaken. They will not come back. Well, my God, give me, they're wrong. Just like Custer, when he said, I'll give you the 7th Cavalry, I'll ride clear through the great Sioux Nation, he was dead wrong. So, what's happened? Now, the great Sioux Nation has come back together for the first time since that very time we defeated you. Stronger than ever. Stronger than ever, Mutakia, because we have been given a prophecy that Brother Nate talked about. We have been given a prophecy that we have a destiny to awaken the entire human family. That's our destiny. Stand up, Mother Earth, in place. Now, Sister Winona said, she talked about the fact about dogs being turned to people. Here's an interesting, another fact, historical fact. On September 3rd, we stopped by the Tehachapi Overlooking Force, Chief Overlooking Force's humble home. That morning of September 3rd of this year, on that very day, 1863, and this is why you have Dakotas on the southern part of Manitoba. On that very day, exactly when those dogs were turned on those people, exactly that day, there was 4,000 Mukpapas and Yankton'a camped right close to where that camp is today. 4,000. Peacefully camped there. At the end of the summer, they had, and this is a historical fact, they had just finished drying 500,000 pounds of buffalo meat. General Sully, you know about the 38 that were hung. The 38 that were hung because of what we call the Great Slaughter in 1862. He was out there, Alfred Sully, General Alfred Sully, even though they put up a white flag. They put up a white flag, even that, he attacked that peaceful village. He massacred over 350 people, took 150 prisoner, and imprisoned them at Fort Randall. And that was the White Stone Massacre. And that's why the people of Cannonball are the exact descendants on the southern part, on the northern part of that reservation, they're in Humptonay. From that very camp that was attacked. That's where they're standing up now in Cannonball. The others split up into right here, Manitoba. They have relations here. That's why the southern part from that 1863 bomb. The same time. And this, I was there that afternoon after we prayed the White Buffalo Calf Pipe. Here they came. They had filed in federal court on Friday the fact that that whole area, the Strong Heart Society had certain things there, graves were there, they knew it federally. All of a sudden, even though there was a federal court action against it, they came in with bulldozers and they bulldozed them back. They destroyed those graves. They destroyed those sacred sites. And that's what you saw. Over 100 rogues had left the camp, they came, and all of a sudden, here they were with dogs. You saw. Do you know those relatives? Because of the prayers, they never acted a violent way. Turned the dogs on, maced them. But in the end, here's something ironic. In the end, the dogs turned on the handlers and started biting them. They started biting the handlers. And then they ran away. They ran away! So, history comes back around, except it's turned our way, like you said, Toshka. It's ours this time. We're winning this time. Last thing I want to say. Oh. But I have to really something. I say this with great love and compassion to those chiefs and councils that are deciding to sign on these pipelines. With really great respect, I say this. We've heard already so beautifully, so eloquently, so powerfully, the other speakers tell why on the spiritual side of things that this is not right to destroy our mother. We've heard that. We know that. That's why we hear it now. But there's another side of the Takiyapi that I ask that these relatives, maybe you share with them. Last week, the two largest multinational insurance companies with $3.2 trillion worth of assets sent a letter to G20 and said, I mean, they made it sound really good inside of climate change, but I know at the bottom line it's money. And I understand why our relatives will sometimes want to sign these agreements because there's such poverty. That's why I really admire those relatives that Ruben's talking about, Toshka Ruben's talking about, are the ones that didn't sign for millions. So they see the money over a period of time. Well, these insurance companies wrote this letter to G20, they said, in 4 years, we give you only 4 years, and you must stop the over $440 million of subsidies. Can you imagine that? $440 billion you're giving these oil companies on top of the money they already gave. They're destroying our water. Not only did they said that in 4 years, they said, we want you to report exactly the cost of what it's cost to get this underground. That means all those pipes that are broken down underneath, they have to fix. That means, what is it going to cost to clean this deal up? So the bottom line is this. It just doesn't make only spiritual sense right now. Anybody who's signing this agreement, any chief of council signing this agreement, they're signing a really bad economic deal. Even if they don't care about the earth. Even the insurance companies are telling you this is a bad investment. I'll tell you what, these insurance companies make sure they make their money. They understand that building these pipelines, getting billions of dollars behind it, is a bad investment. So, big deal. We'll sign a deal. I tell you right now, mark my word for this. Within 10 years, this thing's going to go down the tube. It's going down the tube now. So you still want to sign agreements? Fine. But no, on an economic sense, they're not a good deal. They are not a good deal. They are going to end up giving yourself in real bad economic conditions for signing these agreements because there's not going to be any money to pay back the money that you think you're going. So Mitakiyapi, thank you so very much. We say, my name is Horsley. My name is Flatline. This is an important thing to document me. I stand responsible for the Creator for my words and my actions. Right here. Each of us have it. No limit. We let this happen, it comes right back here. Here. If our children don't have it, it's here. Why they ain't again. Thank you, so you're by the way, you have one great word. I love the post on Facebook.
Brings me, and thank you so much to Chief Lane for the beautiful words, of course, for quoting Stephen Edison, Crazy Horse, on this, the day of the anniversary of the day that he was murdered. I want to take us to our final speaker, last but not least, who's doing some incredibly inspiring things that I think we all need to know about. You know, Winona talked about infrastructure for the people. You know, right now the government's United States and Canada, they want to build infrastructure for billionaires and oil companies. But this woman that I'm about to introduce is one of my best friends in the whole world. I consider her a sister. You know, she's building infrastructure for the people, and she started at home, built a solar installation for her home nation, the Lubicon Cree Nation, right in the heart of the Tar Sands. Melina Lubicon Massimo is a member of the Lubicon Cree First Nation and a climate of the Alberta tar sands to her traditional territory. Lubicon Massimo has been a vocal advocate for Indigenous rights for the last decade. Joining Greenpeace in 2009, she helped raise the alarm bells on the tar sands in Alberta, including a related and tragic incident, one of the largest oil spills in Alberta here in her home care community of Little Buffalo. She's worked with numerous organizations, including taking a global Red Wire Native Media Society, Indigenous Media Arts Society, and Indigenous Portal. Please join me in welcoming Melina here to Treaty 1 to speak tonight at the Thunderbird House.
Teardrop in our traditional territory, and that's where my family lives in the bottom of Little Buffalo. And yet, you know, until this day, we're slowly getting running water. So we haven't had paved roads. We don't have running water. We have septic tanks that are just coming into the community, and yet billions of dollars have left in revenue from our territories. So this is an idea of what our communities are experiencing. The size of mines. So we have mines in the northeastern part of Alberta, which are as big as entire city. Imperial Oil, which will be the seventh mine, will be as big as Washington, D.C. when it's done. So we're dealing with mines that big. And this, we took over the flyover. The little yellow thing is actually the biggest dump truck, so it's about three stories high, as big as this, and it's the biggest dump truck in the world. And they're scraping out the Mother Earth in the bottom of the barrel. Another type that you'll see that is actually another environmental footprint is the underground mining, which happens in our homelands, which is like fracking. It's called in situ, where they inject superheated steam and chemicals, and they contaminate the aquifers underneath, which is our water systems. So they're utilizing a lot of water, 3 to 5 barrels for one barrel of oil. And one of the problems with this is that everybody knows, we know that water is sacred, and we need water to drink. And these companies are basically sucking right now billions and millions of cubic meters of water every single day. And this is coming from pristine water sources like the Athabasca Glacier in the Mackenzie River Basin, which is a sixth of our Canada's fresh water supply. And what we're experiencing with climate change is that we have glaciers that are receding. And so we have this from 1919, 1993. You can see the Athabasca Glacier receding. And this is pristine water the companies are using. And what the problem is too is with our communities and our families, we're all fishing families, just like I'm sure here, and we're finding tumors on the carcass of the moose, but we're also finding tumors on fish. My dad's a hunter, and he found tumors in the moose, like yellow inside. And what you can see is this is actually the byproduct, the toxic byproduct that is flushed out every single day. It's happening right now. 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, they flush out this toxic contamination of polyamide hydrocarbon cyanide, synthetic acids, mercury, lead. It's all toxic, and it's basically leaching into our water system and giving people cancer. And so we're producing one barrel of oil for 1.5 barrels of toxicity that is flushed back into our water systems. And you can see the fish here with the tumors and their deformed spines. And one of the issues too is that in the boreal forest, what we're experiencing is number one deforestation in the entire world. So we've actually passed the Amazon, and nobody even really knew about that. It was a blip in the media a couple of years ago. And so what happens when we're deforested is that we're actually letting off carbon emissions, and so that means we're producing more climate change from not only burning the fossil fuels, but also deforestation produces climate change. And this is what our families are This is the before of where we can harvest medicine. And this is the after that these companies are giving us. And they equivalent land capacity, where they only have to put in 3 species that they destroy of 10. And what we're seeing in our lifetime, by 2040, the woodland arrow will be extinct from our homeland because of this type of extraction. And woodland arrow and the song, migratory songbirds, which are also coming from South America, and we're in a migration path in the Tarzan to the north, and we're also seeing animals dying. And this is what a pipeline spill looks like. This is what would happen if Energy East comes here. This is what happened to my community, where I saw my family being poisoned before my very eyes. 5 years ago, on April 29th, an oil spill happened, one of the biggest in Alberta and Canada's history, 4.5 million barrels spilled down the border, took over Muskeg in our traditional territory. You see our family cleaning it up. This is, the next picture is, we took this from the air. It was so hard to get a helicopter, you could fly over to document their own homelands, where it had people hanging up on these and refusing to fly us over our territory. And this, you can see here, those are people, those little tiny white, they're hazmat suits. Those are people trying to clean up the Muskeg, and that's oil that's all coming through. You know? The government refused to admit that there was a problem. The government refused to say that there should be evacuations of my family, of small children, of elders, of pregnant women, when doctors were calling me and saying women, people should not be evacuated. shoved it onto the carpet and they lied about it. Until after the Harper government got worried for the second time, they finally released the information to my community a day later, 5 days after the spill. And when we went back 15 months later, we still found dead zones when the company had said they cleaned it up, and they didn't. And so what is this issue of pipelines all across Turtle Island that are, you know, the snake that we saw today, that we walked with the snake? You know, my Muslim, many elders have said that there would be snakes in our homelands. But one of the things that the Munio don't know is that it connects our people. And that's what we see is resistance. I never thought I would be in Manitoba speaking about this issue, but it brings us from coast to coast to coast to coast to stop these projects and stop them dead in their tracks.
So here this is us with the solar feast and the ribbon cutting ceremony. And you know, one of the things what Winona touched on earlier was, what is a just transition? You know, it shouldn't be our communities at the end receiving this kind of technology at the end. We should be the first in line to receive it, because we've experienced the brunt of environmental contamination, poison air, poison water, that we should be able to not have to extract from our homelands, but also have regenerative energy. And that's all I have to say. How happy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Wagner hiding behind their flag. God bless you. How do we get together?